Yeah. Just cast it over onto the Lord right now. Jesus, we just cast all our cares. which we have to, but the Bible says to lift holy hands without wrath and doubting. Maybe you've never even done that before, but I encourage you, would you just lift your hands to the Lord? It's just a sign of surrender. God doesn't put a gun in our back to make us raise our hands and surrender. It's a willing choice that we make. God, we just surrender right now. I surrender these next few moments to you. I surrender my mind to you. I surrender everything that I have and everything that I am right now to draw closer to you. Come on, let's worship. Jesus, we love you. We glorify you and magnify. If it helps you to close your eyes, close your eyes. Whatever helps you to get into the presence of God. Whatever helps you eliminate distraction. Oh, we love you, Jesus. We magnify you. Holy, 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 holy. We love you, Lord. Step out and come if you need prayer as we worship.
Yeah. To do.
Prayer, and we're going to be doing a briefing over that, a little training. It's be very simple. You can do it in your home, your apartment, and pray for your neighborhood, and we'll show you how, and it's going to be awesome. We want to get the fall kicked off and saturated in prayer. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
Well, how is everybody this morning?
Good.
Amen. Welcome. If you're watching online, we welcome you. So glad that you are with us watching online, and you picked a really good day to be at church.
Yeah.
We're starting a new series this morning. We're going to entitle it, I Love My Church.
Yeah.
And for some of you, I realize maybe if you're watching or you're here, maybe invited you, maybe you're here and that's not true. Maybe you can't really say that you love church and you're just trying to suffer through the next few minutes so you can get to lunch or whatever, but I'm hoping that maybe by the end of this service, the Holy Spirit begin to touch your heart. I grew up in church. Some of you knew my story, and if you go back to the 80s, some of y'all weren't even born yet. I don't know. The 80s, when I was growing up in church, I was made to go to church, and I would sleep on the back row, and I was skeptical, and here I am over 20 years later, working in one. So if you're skeptical, better watch it. Jesus has a way of getting you like that.
Right.
But we're so glad you're here, and I thought we could start the conversation this morning by talking about things that we do love. Things that we do love. Do we have this first picture? How many of you love dogs? People that love Jesus love dogs, I should say. How many of you have a dog? Some of you love your dog more than your kids, more than your brother, your sister. Some of you may be praying for God to take your dog's life. I don't know where you're at in that picture, but I'm not making my... We love dogs. We have a dog. My dog is more awesome than your dog. We'll just leave it there. But here's something else when I'm about to make your dinner decision today. You didn't want it until you saw it, right? And I start talking about extra cheese and brick-fired oven, all these fresh ingredients. And man, my boys love Meat Lover's Pizza with cheese in the crust. Come on, somebody. I mean, that's proof there's a God. That somebody could even think of that. But anyway, so maybe you love pizza. Maybe you're here and you love pizza, but maybe anybody here, you also love football. Nobody here loves football. Come on. You know you recorded the Texans preseason. It's a preseason practice game. You're going to be watching it like it's the Super Bowl tonight. And for those of you, some of you, you noticed that was Longhorns. I don't want to leave anybody out. Any Aggie fans, there you go, right there. But people that love Jesus also love the Texans. Sorry, Cowboys fans, Saints fans. I got the screen, so that's the way it's going to be this morning. But incidentally, hey, September 4th, Labor Day weekend, we're going to have our luau party. I want you to invite somebody in the next Sunday, 9/11. Wear your team jersey, whatever team you're into, wear it. And then we're going to be giving away two free Texans tickets to the Titans game. So that's going to be pretty exciting. So I thought I'd go ahead and throw that out there. But for me, I want you to know that I really love our church. I love our church, and I'm not just saying that. Now, if you're new to Harvest Family, you're watching online, you're probably thinking, well, of course you love the church, Pastor. You started it. But I want you to know, I love this church in 2010, when it was four or five of us at a Starbucks. We didn't have a building, didn't have a sound system, didn't have anything. We had a passion and a call for God to begin a church in this community, and we were passionate about seeing people that were disconnected from God and come in and experience the presence of God. Yeah. So they can know God. And listen, I love this church, and if it all fell apart tonight, I would be here in the morning working, praying, sweating, because I love this church, not because of how big it is or how small it is, but I love this church because of how awesome God is and the lives that have been and will be changed through what God has started in this church. And man, I look around this auditorium and think about some of you, how God has touched your life and impacted your life and changed you. And some of you have even shared your stories with me. I love how Jesus is using his church and using this church to see lives change. Now, like I said, I haven't always loved church. Like I told you, I grew up and I had a drug problem as a child. I was drugged to church. Some of y'all had a drug. You were drugged to church. And I remember growing up and I'd hear people in church be, oh, this is just like heaven. And I thought, man, if this is like heaven, maybe I want to check out the other place. Because it was awful to me. It wasn't fun. It was boring. I'm thinking, well, here's this person over here. They haven't smiled in 20 years. They may not be going to heaven. I don't know. But listen, anyways, especially here in Texas culture, I grew up born, I'm a fourth generation native Texan. I know, man, it's awesome. We have people that were I come to this church and were born in Africa, in India, in Asia. And I love it, and I love how diverse Houston is. I absolutely get into it. I love it. And I love that this church is diverse. But let me just tell you, if you grew up in Texas, a lot of the culture, the church culture in Texas is, how many know, for a lot of us, it's like we tolerate church. We go to church on Sunday. That's just what we do, and I'm speaking from my experience, but let me just tell you, none of you as a child went to church as a kid because you love church. Very few. None of you, your parents woke you up on Sunday and said, "We're going to church because it's so awesome." No. A lot of you, your dad cussed on the way to church. Your mom and dad argued on the way to church. You fought with your brother and sister on the way to church. Your mama was jack-slapping you on the way to church. It's like Brooke's dad tells a story of his dad. They're on the way to church, and there were five kids, and he is reaching back here trying to drive, and they were fighting and fussing. He was reaching back there, hitting them, slapping them, and I think it was Steve and one of the brothers. He hit them, and he said, "Hey, why didn't you hit me? I didn't even do anything." He said, "Well, you probably did it." And then when you got to church, you had to pretend that there was no problem, that everything was perfect, that you had it all together. And if you didn't, if your halo wasn't adjusted on just right, they'd kick you out. They'd snub you. Come on, somebody, don't shout me down because I'm preaching good.
Come on, you're preaching
good. And so for some of us, church was something that we tolerated. But I want you to know, the more that I read Scripture, the more I realize that church is not something to be tolerated, it's something to be celebrated.
Yeah.
Something to be celebrated. And it ought to be the best event of our week. And it should not just be an event on Sunday. It should be a movement that we live in Monday through Saturday. And we're a part of the kingdom of God in this earth. Come on, somebody. You need to get excited about that. And I love the local church because of the awesome potential that the local church has. And I know this sounds weird. This sounds weird. It would come across weird to some of your friends to say, I love my church. I mean, some of you be like, "Man, that's kind of over the top." In fact, if you told some people that you loved your church too much, they might say, "I don't know. He might be an adult. Isn't it amazing? It's all right to be crazy about your team on Saturday and Sunday, but if you're crazy about your God on Sunday, you're not a fan, you're a fanatic.
Come on.
You call me what you want, you call the church what you want, but I want you to know the church is here to stay. It is the church of the living God that Jesus bled, suffered, and died for, and we are going to touch lives right here at 14950 Cypress Point, Houston. We're going to touch this community and region and the nations of the world because Jesus didn't call us to play games or to play church. He called us to make a difference. Somebody shout amen. And that's why I love the church. And why is it weird? Why should it be weird to love a church? Is that weird? I mean, it's not weird to love a dog. And I mean, your dog, they just eat your food, lick you, use the bathroom, die, and then you're sad. Then you watch Marley and Me or Old Yeller and you want to drive your car off a cliff because a dog dies, and you're sad. Why do you love pizza? Because it gets you to Jesus quicker, clogs your arteries quicker. Some of us love tropical vacation. You might still be paying the one off you went to 5 years ago. I don't know, but we love tropical vacations. Hello, somebody. Why do we love guys on the football field that some of them, you don't even know their name? They certainly don't know your name. And we're crazy about them. You know, it's funny to me, we can spend hundreds or thousands of dollars on tickets and fan merchandise and not give a dime to the one who died and bled and suffered for us.
Amen.
We love them. We love, and that's okay. But for some reason, why is it not okay to get excited about and to love your church? And I think that that mindset ought to change. Yeah. Shout with me, I love my church.
Love my church.
Turn to somebody beside you and tell them I love my church more than you love your church. See, I think it's okay to love church. In fact, if we're really followers of Jesus, it's okay to love what Jesus loved. And I love my church. Now, here's another reason I love my church. And it's because of this story that takes place in Matthew. We're like, is he actually going to read this finally? But anyway, you can turn there. And if you have a KJV, it's called Saint Matthew, which is interesting because he's way, way far away from being a saint when we encounter him for the first time in Scripture. He was a tax collector. I'll just leave that there. You can look at that. But look at Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. This is really cool. Let's check it out. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, everybody on 1, 2, 3, say Caesarea Philippi. 1, 2, 3. Caesarea Philippi. Thank you, got it. And he asked the disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? Great question. Let's just stop right there. Now, in American culture, we miss a lot here because, to my knowledge, this is the only time in Scripture that we read where Jesus went to this place called and when people who first read this story in that context and in that culture read that he went to, they gasped. You know why? Because the religious people hung out at Jerusalem. That's where the good Orthodox religious people, they didn't go to. No. It's in northern Israel. It's real close to the present-day Syrian border. It's probably a lot of minefields and everything else around there now. But, I mean, Jerusalem's where the religious people hung out. But is where the messy people lived. That's where the messy people, when I say messy, I'm talking about the worst stuff imaginable. I mean, for some of you that you didn't know Jesus on your high school or college spring break trip, can we just get real here? You didn't know Jesus on your spring break trip, let's put spring break trip, high school or college without Jesus, plus Mardi Gras, plus Vegas nightlife, all rolled up into one times 100, and then you're getting close to. Are y'all with me? Full of messy people doing bad things. Now here's the other thing about it. Man, I love how y'all help me preach. It took Jesus a week to get there. You know, he walked everywhere. He walked everywhere. And from where he was previously in Matthew's gospel, it took him a week, 7 days to walk, and it was an uphill walk for Jesus to get there. And so anytime that Jesus goes to a geographical location, it's very important that we pay attention just where he's at geographically, because many times Jesus is making a point just by where he's at. So the fact that he went to where the messy people were, and guess what? The nickname of Caesarea Philippi was the gates of hell.
Wow.
You know, you're driving in town, welcome to Houston, the gates of hell. I mean, aren't you glad H-Town does not stand for you know what? wouldn't that be freaky? I'm going in this place. Think about it. Wow, that is just a great nickname, is it not? But think about this. I love the fact that Jesus went into a city full of messy people. Think about it. Think about it. Jesus went there. Translation, Jesus is not scared or intimidated by messy people.
Amen.
He doesn't run from messy people. He doesn't hide from messy people. And I think that that's something the church needs to begin to wrap its mind around, because for so long the church has said, well, if you'll come to us and you'll become like us, we'll accept you. Jesus said, no, I'm like us so we could become like him. Powerful. And our mission as the blood-bought church is still his mission. Amen.
Amen.
I love messy people. Because I are one. I want to serve messy people. And you know, if you're new to Harvest, man, I encourage you to come, not next Sunday, but the next on the 28th at 10 a.m. right through here. We're going to have a Get Connected, and we can share with you how can you can be more of a part of our church, because this is not just, the being the church is not just coming and sitting in a building. Being the church is a part of seeing messy lives changed and transformed by the love of Jesus and being Jesus to broken people. That's why some of you started coming to Harvest Family, because you found a place where, man, it seems like there's genuine warmth and love here.
Amen.
There's an atmosphere of genuine love and acceptance, and you found out, you know what, it's okay to not be okay, but it's not okay to stay not okay, because God loves you too much for you to stay that way. And we have to draw a line in the sand. Are we going to decide, do we want to be that church that loves messy people?
Amen.
We have to decide, are we going to be that church? We want to be the church where people say, I don't know if I want to come to that church because there's a lot of messy people that go to that church. You know what? That shouldn't be a deterrent for you. Actually, that should make you feel welcome. And you know, right now, the people that are judging messy people, one day, they're going to need the grace of those same people, because at some point, you know, the people that put on this hyper super spirituality or this perfectionist complex are normally the ones that are hiding something that they need God to heal in their life. Come on, somebody, let's just be real. God didn't call us to look down our nose at people. He called us to keep our eyes on Jesus and to love people.
Come on.
Well, listen, now I want to tell you this. Now, this person that I'm sharing this story is not here now. They're moved, and so I don't want you to think I'm talking about anybody in this church. I never embarrass anybody, but I just share this with you to make a point. But one time I visited an individual who was part of our church, and they were really struggling. And when I went, his wife had let me in, and he was on the backyard, the back porch there. And when I went back there to meet with him, talk with him, he was smoking a joint. And what's so funny, I guess he wasn't expecting me, but I guess he'd already lit it, and he didn't want to waste it, so he just kept smoking a joint. And I'm loving on him, talking to him, ministering to him. And guess what? I thought I was going to get high, but I'm going to say it. But think about what I'm trying to say to you is, we need to get over ourselves and just love people where they're at.
Amen.
And it makes me so thrilled that this individual felt comfortable enough around me to call me pastor in the middle of their struggle. Because let me know, when you're struggling, what's the enemy want you to do? Hide, stay away, get away. And a lot of times the culture in the church has been to encourage that. Oh, we don't want to be around that. Come on, somebody. And I'm not an FBI agent for Jesus. Don't be worried if I bust up on you. I'm not Holy Hitman, okay? I'm not. Oh man, some of you thought, who's that guy in the trench coat's been following me around? That's how I get my sermon material, right? Oh Lord. But all right, to have a good time in God's house. You know what our job is? I want you to just jot this down on the back side of your handout. You know what our job is? Love and lift.
Yeah,
love and lift. That's your job description. Say it with me. Love and lift. That's what we've guys called us to do. And so we don't need to be naive. We just need to grow up and get real and really start loving.
Thank you.
Guess what? This church is not just for you to grow. This church is also for the people in this community that don't even know God yet. Amen? So that they can connect with God. And we have to decide, do we want to be a hospital for the hurting? Do we want to be a hospital where people can be born into the kingdom of God? Or do we just want to be a museum for dead saints? Amen? No, for the rest of my life, I want to pastor and love messy people. I want to see Jesus change and transform people, and people that say, you know what? I'm not where I need to be. Maybe, Pastor, I'm struggling where I am in my walk with God. But you know what? I'm trying to take a step forward, and you ought to praise God that you are a part of a church environment where people are welcome and it's okay to not be okay, and we can love them into the kingdom of God. Can I have an amen? How many of you say, I want to help you reach messy people, Pastor? Let me see. I want to help reach messy people. I want to reach messy people, love messy people, and serve messy people, because guess what? Jesus went there. And he went there to a place called, to the place where messy people were. He said, who do people say that I am? He got the conversation started about himself in the environment of where messy people were. So when you step back into your workplace tomorrow, or you go to school or class or wherever you go, and you think, man, I can't talk about Jesus here because there's a lot of messy people here, that is the very place where the conversation about Jesus needs to be happening. We should feel the freedom to do what Jesus did, and that's begin the conversation about him in an environment of messy people. And here's what I know about messy people. If Jesus didn't love messy people, he sure wouldn't love me. And he sure wouldn't love you. And if you're a Christian, that's true about you. I don't care if you were born in the church, if you were born on the altar at the church, if you took communion out of a baby bottle, and you were baptized 5 seconds after you were born, and you recited the Apostles' Creed at age 4, you were still born lost as a sinner in need of God. Amen? And you were a mess, and Jesus was so awesome and full of love and grace that he cleaned up our mess, and you and I are in the kingdom today because Jesus loves messy people.
Thank you.
Yes,
he does. Thank you, Father.
That's why we're having a luau party on September 4th. So we're going to put some flyers in your hand. Hopefully next Sunday we can start inviting messy people. So we can love on them. The reason so many church people don't love messy people is because there's a lot of people that don't realize how messy they are.
Thank you.
Or they were.
Thank you.
And I've been guilty of this too, but you know what? When you see messy people, you know how you need to see them? You don't need to see them how they are. You need to see them as how you were.
Amen.
And not only that, maybe we need to see them as I would be, but for the grace of God.
Amen.
And if we did that, man, we could begin to show grace to people that the church has not, in a way that the church has not shown in a long period of time. Let's keep going. Verse 14. Well, they replied, some say you're John the Baptist. Some say Elijah. Others say Jeremiah, one of the prophets. Then he asked them, but who do you say that I am? That is the most important question in the history of the world. Who do you say that Jesus is? Everybody's going to have to answer that question. So I'm not going to answer that. No, you're going to have to, every single person that's ever lived will have to answer that question. Listen, that's the final exam for life. I mean, you're not going to pass without getting that one right, okay? Look at this, verse 16. Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Now here's what's cool about this. Peter is basically saying to Jesus, Jesus, I think that you are the hope of the world. That's basically what Peter was saying. Jesus Christ, You are the hope of the world. Jesus, who do I think you are? You are the hope of the world. And Jesus is basically replying back, ding, 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 ding. You're the grand prize winner, Peter. That's the answer. Watch this in verse 17. Jesus said, you are blessed, Simon, son of John, because of my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You didn't learn this from any human being. Now, I say to you that you are Peter, which means small stone, and upon this rock, the Greek word there means rock, like rock of Gibraltar, and that rock, he's using a play on words. Peter's name is Petros, which means small rock or stone, but he said, upon the rock, Gibraltar. In other words, Jesus said, upon myself and upon this declaration that I am the hope of the world, I will build my church. Jesus said, I will build my church. I will build my church. I will build my church. Let me just stop here and say it's really popular in our culture and in pop culture today to say, well, I love Jesus and I'm a Christian, but I don't really need church. And if you're on a path in which, let me just say this, if you're on a path in which you're walking with Jesus, I would argue that Jesus is not going to lead you away from something that he died to put into this world. That he gave his life for. Nobody gets an out clause because the church, guess what? The church has been around for 2,000 years. It's outlived the Roman Empire. It's outlived every nation on them. This church has been around. And if Jesus doesn't come back before then, the church is going to be around another 2,000 years. God help us. I will build my church. And look at this. All the gates of hell or the power of hell will not conquer it or overcome it. Now, when he said that, think about this. What's the nickname of Caesarea Philippi? The gates of hell. I believe when Jesus was teaching this, he was looking at this town and he's saying, the gates of hell cannot prevail against my church. Think about how bad the world is, all the incredible things that are going on around us. And guess what? Think about this. Gates are not an offensive weapon. Gates are a defensive weapon. And Jesus' thought is this. Jesus is saying, we're the church and the gates of hell will not prevail against us. In other words, we're not on the defensive. We are on the offensive. We're the ones taking the gospel to the gates of hell, to the worst parts of the world, and to the messiest people. The gates of hell cannot prevail against the light of the church. Are you hearing me? Wow. The gates of the powers of hell, the gates of hell will not prevail. Powerful, powerful. And think about this. Jesus said, based on your statement, Peter, that I am the hope of the world, we're going to start a movement called the church. That word's ecclesia, or called out one. Say it with me. I've been called out.
I've been called out.
And we're calling other people out.
We're calling other people.
Calling other people out of darkness. Calling other people out of hopelessness. Calling other people out of broken situations. And Jesus is saying, none of you guys, disciples, really know what this is right now, but this is going to be such an incredible movement that you are going to gladly lay your life down.
Come on. Amen.
It's going to be so powerful, it's going to impact the messy people everywhere you go and share this message. People that have no hope, people that have given their lives to whatever the world has told them would satisfy them, and it hasn't, and they've had broken promise after broken promise, and they're broken and they're hurt and they're bankrupt. This movement is going to bring them the hope and the love that they're looking for.
Yeah.
And we're going to sweep the nations.
Come on.
And people are not going to be outcast anymore. They're going to be included. We're calling them out and we're calling them to the church. And guess what? Jesus promised that that would happen. Now, you may not like church, and you may not have agreed with anything that I've said up to this point, or if you're watching online, but you have to agree with this statement right here. A promise is only as good as the person making the promise. Because we've all had promises made to us, And we've all had promises broken.
Yes, sir.
Right? Yes, sir. So let me just do, I want a real quick survey. I want everybody to play along. This is going to be fun, okay? So don't get psyched out or act super spiritual. Let's just make an appointment with this. Now, how many of you have or have had at any point in time in your life student loan payment? Yes, yes, yes. Student loan payment. Yes, I paid on mine for about 15 years, praise God. And it can get really bad if you change your major like 7 times. I wouldn't, you'd have both hands up if you did that. Now, how many of you have now or have had a car payment? Let me see your hands. I'm not Dave Ramsey. I'm not going to yell at you. Okay, just be, just, okay. How many of you have or have had a house payment? Let me see your hands. Yes, thank you. Thank you for your honesty. I'm in that club also. And lots of people. Now, how many of, if you had someone call you today and they said, I'm interested in paying off your student loan payment. Or I'm interested in, how many of you would be interested in, if it was legitimate and it was not a scam, I mean, how many of you would be interested in taking that call? Let me see your hands. Some of you didn't even have one, but you want the call anyway. And you would take the call. I want to pay off your car. You like go out and buy a car and then, hold on just a second, let me call you back. Go out and buy a car. Yes. Some of y'all, how many of you say, you want to pay off my house? You'd be interested in that call. Let me see your hands. Some of y'all are not even playing right now. You're just being big chief, no fun right now. It's all right. I'm not going to lead you anywhere wrong here, okay? But think about this. If you got that call, you don't get excited about that phone call until you know for a fact that the person on the other end of that line has the ability to do what they're telling you they're going to do, right?
Yes.
Think about this for a second. I want you to think about your most broke, weird, crazy relative in your family. Okay? Just think about it for broke, weird, crazy relative. Okay? We all have dysfunctional families. You just got to put the fun in dysfunction.
Wow.
Think about that person. Somebody like, I can't think about him. Maybe you're the one. Everybody in your family just thought about you. Just glad you're here. Jesus loves messy people. Just keep coming back to church. Just kidding. But if they called and they said, I want to pay off your house and your car and your student loan payment, you would not go, woo! You'd be like, hey, babe, I think Uncle Fred needs to get back to rehab because he's found the crack pipe. Again.
Come on.
And we need to get him some help. But what if this guy called you? Anybody know who that is? My 9-year-old. What do you want to be when you grow up, Mike? I want to be Bill Gates. Bill Gates' net worth is somewhere around the neighborhood of $78 billion. And guess what? Bill Gates is the 37th most wealthy country in the world. Did you hear what I said? He's wealthier than some countries. Now, think about this. $78 billion at around 6% interest today. Bill Gates is making somewhere around 117 bucks a second. I mean, if he stops to pick up a $100 bill, he loses money. He should have just left it there. For me. But Bill Gates, if he never made another dime, he's somewhere around 60 right now, but if he spent $6 million a day till he was the age of 90, that's the only way he could exhaust his wealth. $6 million. So I know some of you are, oh, spending all that money don't make you happy. I'd like to give it a shot. Let me give it a try. I could do a lot for Jesus. Man, I could build a lot of orphanages. I could. Jesus and have fun doing it. But let's just say Bill Gates got your number and he said, I want to pay off your loans, I want to pay off your car, I want to pay your house off, and I'd like to pay off your dog because you probably financed your dog. Pay off everything, and it's Bill Gates, it's not your broke, busted relative. There tends to be more excitement. Doesn't there? Because Bill actually has the coin to come through for you. Now thank you, Shane. Bill can go back to his multi-billion dollar mansion. Think about this for a second. Jesus made the promise, I'm going to build my church. And Jesus actually made a lot of promises. Jesus said stuff like, all you who are weary and heavy laden, come unto me and I'll give you rest. Jesus made promises like, in this world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world and I have given you my peace. Jesus made crazy promises like, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Nobody in history ever made crazy promises like that. And if you would just read them for face value, it would be insane. Insane. And in fact, five times after this place in Matthew 16, Jesus got his disciples together and he told them, here's what's going to happen. We're going to go to Jerusalem. They're going to arrest me. They're going to beat me. They're going to mock me, murder me. And in 3 days, I'm coming back. And guess what? He made that promise. And you know what? None of them believed it. And don't be so hard. We're so hard on the disciples, aren't we? But we probably wouldn't have believed it either. But here's the deal. We can follow Jesus, not just because of what he said. We can follow him because of what he did. Because of Jesus and what he did. It's a historical fact that he rose from the dead, that he defeated sin, death, hell, and the grave. You and I can follow him because of what. And guess what? Guess what? Jesus has more grace than Bill Gates ever thought about having money. Jesus has more power and more life and more joy than Bill Gates ever thought about having money. And he's able to fulfill the promises that he makes. And you and I get to be a part of something that he put in this planet called his church, his blood-bought church. And the Bible says, husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. Guess what? You are a part of something that is near and dear to the heart of Jesus that he promised to build. And if you and I are a part of that promise, we are not going under. We are going over. Can I have a better amen? You can be filled with hope today. I don't care what you're going through. If you're a part of the church, you're a part of something awesome. It's an amazing privilege and honor to be a part of the body of Christ. And we need to begin to take the time to really think about and process through what we are a part of. The only thing that Jesus, who defeated death and on the grave, left on this planet, besides the Holy Spirit, as his legacy to humanity, the church. Wow. And I think we need to let that begin to underscore our priority and our commitment and begin to understand our purpose for being on this planet. Amen. I love the church because Jesus died to bring it into this world. Let's stand to our feet all across this building. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, I want to give you the opportunity to be a part of the church, to know Jesus, and to let him change your heart and your life. If you're watching this online, I want to give you the opportunity to be a part of Jesus' body, the body of Christ, Man, how awesome is that? Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here, you say, I don't know Jesus. I wouldn't consider myself a part of His church. I'm not talking about membership to this local church right now as much as I'm talking about you just know that you know Jesus and you're a part of the body of Christ. And if that's you, you're watching online and you're unsure about that, you don't have to be unsure. You can know that Jesus loves you. You're accepted in the beloved. All you have to do is accept and receive what He did for you on the cross. And by faith, you believe and you say, Jesus, I turn my back on my old way of life and I want to be reborn. Reborn. Born again. Born anew. That's what reborn spiritually. From death to life. From unrighteousness to being made the righteousness of God in Christ by your identification with the substitutionary death of Jesus. You just accept what He did, you believe it, and you get to be what He is because He became what you were. And by faith, you embrace that and accept that. If you're here, you're watching online, you say, I want to accept Jesus into my life. Count to three. I just want you to slip up your hand. 1, 2, 3. Just slip it up so I can pray with you. Or you're watching online, I want you to pray. I want everybody to pray with me out loud together just as a support, encouragement to those that are praying right now. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. According to your grace, the finished work of the cross, I accept what you did for me. I believe that you are the Savior and the hope of the world. I turn my back on sin. I receive and embrace you as my Savior. Become the Lord of my life. Holy Spirit, come into my heart. Come into my life. I declare, according to the Word of God, that I am saved. I am set free. I have been made righteous and born again by your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's just give Jesus a hand of praise. We're so thankful. God, we're so thankful that you love messy, messy people, of which all of us are. Pastor Tommy, I want you to come. I want us to make this declaration together. And after Tommy, Brother Tommy prays, I want you to find about 3 or 4 people and just tell them, you know, I'm so glad he loves messy people. And I love my church, but I want us to make this declaration. Can you just say it with me? I am bought with his blood.
I am bought with his blood.
I am the body of Christ.
I am the body of Christ.
Bone of his bone.
Bone of his bone.
Flesh of his flesh.
Satan has no power over me.
I overcome evil with good. I am an overcomer.
I am an overcomer.
The Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in me. I am in His church. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I am redeemed from the curse. I have the mind and wisdom of Christ. I am born of God. He is working in me. He loves through me. I am victorious in Him. In Jesus' name. Now let's give Him a hand clap of praise. Been good to have been in God's house.
Amen.
And you know what the altar call is to this message? Go love messy people.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Pastor Tom, would you pray? Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We love you. Thank you so much, Father, for loving us through every messy trial, Father. We love you. We bless you. We praise you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for the Spirit of God in our hearts. And Lord, we just love you. Thank you for our dear pastors. Thank you for every soul here, Father, that heard your word. May we spread your word all through this land today.
In Jesus' name, let the church say amen.